Hello and welcome back to the Master Division of the International Championship. It's the last game now that will decide how I will be placed in the final standings. And yeah, after my strong start, sadly the last three games didn't go that well, but I still have a chance for the first place. I am 2 points behind Mushan, who is in the first place, but he is in another game, an additional game, in addition to that one. And yeah, so when I win this game and he does not win the other game, then I would still win the league. But of course, I have to win this game for that, and that's of course not that easy. Prem and fight trigger for those it goes against relegation, so those two players don't have a chance for the first place anymore. Yeah, let's first of all take a look at the Leaders and Wonders. The International Red Cross is there. Bill Gates, Sid Meier and Albert Einstein is there. No Pierre, but Marlene and Charlie Chaplin. There's also Bach and Joan of Arc, so DJ Parsons' Dream Combo is here. Then we have James Watt, Maria Theresa, Shakespeare, James Cook and the Suez Canal. And then we have the Ocean Liner Service. Yeah, no Siska, but Nostradamus, Genghis Khan, Joan of Arc, so some other strength leaders. I'm in the first position and I decided to pick the Library of Alexandria. And like this, I maybe get either Caesar or Aristotle, hopefully. Oh, for sure, because the other three players can of course not take four leaders. So probably one of those leaders, and yeah, the library is just a very strong wonder, so I decided to pick that up. I could of course go for Hammurabi maybe, but then I might end up with the Colossus. It's not that bad, because Suez Canal and James Cook are in the game, but the library is just a very strong wonder, so I decided to go for that. Then Bram has a strong pick as well. He can take the Stonehenge and an additional leader, and he decides to go for Hammurabi. Fightrigger takes Cleopatra and the Pyramids. That's also a strong start for him. And Mushan doesn't have the best card left for him, but he can take Aristotle and Cultural Heritage. So that means that I will get Caesar, but maybe I have another option. And there is Sun Tzu and Alex, but I decided to go for Caesar. I could of course say I want to pay an additional civil action to get the yellow token of Alex, but I'm in first position and Caesar can do some work there. It's of course a little bit of Orion's, whether I draw some nice events or not. But just drawing some additional cards, maybe being able to see a little bit more in the deck, isn't that bad, especially in the first position when I can maybe then try to win some strength events. So I decided to go for Caesar, and then I can build my mine and increase my population. And I draw two events and two colonies, so I have to decide whether I want to play those two in. The Suez Canal is in the game, so when I play those two colonies in, then that will probably be a good wonder for one player. But I will have the knowledge that the colonies are in there, and maybe I can pick up cartography. Bram can take the Engineering Genius in addition to electing Hammurabi and building mine, increasing population. Fight Rigger starts with building a lab, and then after increasing population, he has still one civil action left because he already took Leader and Wonder with his first pick, so he can take the rich land, which is nice for him because he didn't build a third mine yet. And Mushan goes for Aristotle, builds a mine, increases population. He's now the choice to either play Cultural Heritage and then maybe go for St. Peter's Basilica or Forbidden City next turn, or he can take the Colossus. And he decides to take the Colossus and the Suez Canal and Cooker in the game. He's in fourth position, so that maybe will help him to not be the weakest. And yeah, so I guess that's a fine pick. And I'm Caesar, so You can expect that I will play a lot of events in and that there are some strength events, maybe some colonies, so that's another point for the Colossus. And I decided to play those colonies in. I started with the developed territory because when there's the development of politics revealed, then I might get another some more events, and then I can maybe keep this in hand because it's inhabited is maybe a little bit stronger. I mean, the developed territory is fine as well, but then I could keep this in hand and wait until I know if I have a good chance at winning those territories. But there's not the development of politics revealed, but the development of markets, and then there's the development of religion. So I can take the religion. I decided to build two stages in the library, and I do this because there are already three other nice wonders, and when I start building the library, I have the option to pick one of those up. And yeah, then I have two civil actions left, and first I thought that I maybe want to pick the urban growth one, but at the end I decided to increase my population and grab the urban growth A. So I basically save one civil action because I increase my population now, but I lose one resource and one food. So it's maybe a little bit of a close decision. But when I draw some more events, then it is quite likely that a lot of developments are open. So it might be nice to have used the civil action already. And when I want to pick one of those wonders up, then it also might be nice to that I increase my population already this turn. Yeah, so I decided to go for increasing population and take the urban growth. And even with that urban growth, I would have enough resources to finish the library and build a lab if I want to do this. So, yeah. And I draw two more events, so that's quite nice. Bram starts building on the Stonehenge, maybe wants to be able to pick one of those wonders up as well. Because he there is no technology that he can go for immediately, and when there is no technology, then I do normally still build a lab before I finish the Stonehenge, but he maybe wants to be able to pick one of those wonders. And when there's a code of laws, a monarchy maybe on two for him at the next turn, he might be happy to have built a Stonehenge. Then there is the development of civil life, and Fightrigger can use the development of religion, builds a mine, builds one stage of the pyramids, and then he takes the urban growth and a stockpile. And Mushan decides to go for Leonardo. He's probably eyeing those alchemies. There are two copies, so it's quite likely that he will get one. And at the next turn, he will have four signs, or even five, when he grabs an alchemy with Aristotle. And then he can go for Leonardo immediately, and that should be a strong start for him. And he gets iron as well, so he can maybe build a strong economy. And that he picks Leonardo means that all of those wonders are there at one civil action for me, so I can decide if I want one of those wonders and yeah, which one I want. I decided, of course, to seed some more events in. It's definitely nice to have a lot of knowledge about the deck. And the development of trade routes is opened, and the development of planning. And the options here are agriculture, development of politics, and development of crafts. And I decided to go for development of crafts because I decided to pick another wonder app up, and then I can use the resources quite nicely. And yeah, the other players are kinda prepared to take another wonder as well. So I decided that I don't want to take the St. Peter's Basilica. I really like the Basilica. But the Universitas, it's still quite early, so I decided to pick the Universitas up. And because of that decision, I decided to use my development of civil life in that way that I built a fourth mine. Instead of putting the population into the lab, I put it into the mine because when I built the Universitas, I have should have enough science production for a while, and I can rather use this population in a mine then, especially because there are the new deposits in the deck. And I sadly only have 8 resources at the next turn, but the deck might flip and there are new deposits and knowledge of the ancients, and both events would give me enough resources to finish in the library at the Universitas at the next turn. So that could be quite nice. And as last action now, I have to get out of corruption. I cannot increase my population, so I have to start building on the Universitas. This time I don't draw 2 events, but I was quite lucky to draw already 4 events that I could play in. Sadly, I do not draw any defense cards for the colonies that are in there, but I can maybe play in the foray and maybe offer one of those pacts, so maybe I can still use my 2 politics actions. Bram decides to build a second lab now. He takes the monarchy, develops the monarchy, and decides to pick up the Forbidden City. Fire Trigger plays an event in, so the deck will now flip. And he opens the development of science. He can finish the pyramids now. He needs a new project for Cleopatra. There is no wonder, so he decides to pick up one of those alchemies. Then he has to get out of corruption, so he increases his population, and he takes the theology as well. Shan plays an event in, and sadly not the new deposits or the knowledge of the agents, but another territory, the strategic territory, and Bram is able to win it for 1 warrior and 1 defense card, so that's quite nice for him. And the second copy of Alchemy is still there for Moshan, so he can take it with Aristotle, then elect Leonardo. He can develop the Alchemy, has now 10 resources, so that's quite a lot. And he builds one lab, builds the warriors to get out of corruption, and then he can still take the engineering genius that he can use nicely on the Colossus. I decided to play in the foray first to have knowledge about what my turn might look like, and the knowledge of the ancients is opened, and that is quite nice for me. So I have now enough resources to finish the Universitas. Because when no of those resource events would be revealed, then I could think about offering the Trade Routes Agreement to be able to finish the Universitas. Of course, then the other players might not accept, because that would be quite nice for me. But like this, I can offer the Open Borders Agreement to Bram. We both already have some military actions, so yeah. So I don't help out Moshan or Fire Trigger too much. And Bram accepts, so that's quite nice. I have some science, so I can go for the Code of Laws and develop it. I have not enough resources to finish the Universitas. Then I have 1 civil action left. I could just increase population, but taking the irrigation is quite nice. I have 4 resources, so I could upgrade 2 farms at my next turn when I want to. And yeah, and, so I can increase my economy even more at the next turn immediately. And I have a lot of knowledge about the event deck. Strategic territory is already out, so there's only 1 event left that I don't know about. And so there could only be 1 strength event in there. So I know that I, for this event deck, don't have to worry a lot about strength events. And now I draw 2 defense cards, that's quite nice, and a border conflict. Bram opens the developed territory, and I am able to win it for my warrior and 2 colonization cards. Bram decides to go for the masonry. He can use that immediately to finish the Forbidden City. And he has now a lot of civil actions and even Hammurabi, so basically 7 civil actions, especially because he has now the 4th military action, and he can take a lot of yellow cards. Fight Rigger takes the knights, develops the knights, and builds one knight, and then he can still use Cleopatra and start upgrading the alchemy. And then he decides to develop the theology, so maybe there are dark ages in there. But maybe he just wanted to use the civil action efficiently when he plans to go for theology anyway. Mushan does now finish his Colossus. And he increases his population, builds a warrior, so he's now at 7 strength, so that could be, get a little bit dangerous. And he takes the rich land that he can use nicely for his mine upgrades. I have a little bit of a problem here, because Mushan at the seventh is at 7 strength, and I just used 2 defense cards, so it might get a little bit tricky. But I can increase my population 2 times and build 2 warriors, so I'm safe for the moment with my 4 military actions. And now there are some cards that I can pick up. And there is the warfare. I don't have any other military technology, so it could maybe be nice to pick up the warfare just to be safe if Mushan increases his strength even more. But I kinda want to get my economy going, and taking that and developing it would cost 2 civil actions, and I really could miss those. So I decided to rather take the rich land, take the iron, and then develop the irrigation. I want to increase my food production first, because when I want to compete in strength, then I need another population that I can hopefully put in a knight when I get one copy of knight and go for one phalanx. So I want to get my food up first and the iron after that. Yeah, and like this I can upgrade my food production and still grab the knights. And maybe already go for some iron upgrades in addition to that, because I only need to upgrade this once. So then I would still have enough resources for one mine upgrade. And I draw another defense card and a naval trade agreement. And I decided to not push the border conflict in, because the fray is in there, and at the moment I am not really prepared to win this, and there might be some more strength events, so at this point I rather wanted to slow down the deck a little bit. Brahm takes Eleanor and elects her immediately to go for the Taj Mahal, and he builds another mine, and that's quite an interesting decision, because he does not really have a lot of population. So now he has no population left. He can of course use the reserves for food, but he just grabbed the Taj Mahal, that needs a lot of resources, so maybe he wants to use the reserves rather for resources. And yeah, when there is a lot of strength play, it could get a little bit dangerous for him. Then Fightrigger can use Cleopatra again for another upgrade of to alchemy. Then he can play Stockpile, this helps him to get out of corruption, because now he can increase his population and build another knight. He grabs the Code of Laws, he has some nice science production, and then he uses the Urban Growth to upgrade the temple to theology. And Mushan opens the new deposits, so some more resources are gained. And he takes the Swordsman and he increases his strength, so I might have to follow up with some strength increase. And he upgrades another lab to alchemy to get out of corruption. But the age might end until his next turn, then he could have some happiness problems. I definitely decided to pick up one of those knights, but at this point I don't have the population, and Yeah, I don't have enough defense cards to defend against Mushan. I want to go for new leader. When I take Saladin, I can take the strength of Saladin. And yeah, and then but then I have one military action left, and I still would have not enough military actions. And I could maybe go for the Theocracy, that would be maybe the safe play, but at that point I decided to just take the strength of Saladin and hope that Mushan doesn't play an aggression or that I draw a defense card. And I developed the knights. But that was maybe a little bit greedy, maybe I should just play it safe and go for the Theocracy. Of course that then I maybe cannot go for an H2 government. But I would be safe from an aggression, and yeah, and when the age ends, then Mushan even draws some H2 cards, and when I get hit by bad H2 aggression, that could be really bad. So it was definitely quite a risk. That was maybe unnecessary, especially because I was quite happy about my start with the Universitas and the mines. I have now the food going. I can go for Iron X, so I have a strong start, and maybe I should not risk the start unnecessary. But yeah, I decided to do it like this. Take the strength of Saladin. Sadly, I do not draw another defense card, but there were already some used for the colonies, so there are not a lot of them left. And now I have to hope that Mushan doesn't play an aggression against me. The inhabited territory was opened, and I really hoped that Mushan would win this, so that he cannot play an aggression against me. But Bram was able to win it. I bid 2 for that, and maybe that was a mistake, because that might say Mushan that I only have one defense card. Maybe I should take a little bit of risk and bid my 2 warriors and 1 card for 3. And then he would maybe think that I have 2 defense cards and then would not play an aggression against me when he has one. But of course that would be a little bit risky because there's also the chance that I would win the colony. But yeah, it's quite a nice colony. Fightrigger can bid a knight for that, so maybe it's not that risky. And I could have done it. Bram goes for knights as well. And yeah, he has now not a lot of population, but he can use the reserves for food and increase his population another time, so he has now at least 2 knights, and that's enough strength for now. He has the strategic territory as well, and he picks then up the irrigation. Fightrigger plays an event in, and the immigration is opened. I think that was played in by him, because I played 4 events in, and I think he played the other 2 in, when I remember correctly. So now it makes even more sense that he went for the theology. And of course, the theology will be nice when the age will now end, so he already has his happy face problems fixed. And he can use Cleopatra one last time, thanks to the immigration, and can build another alchemy. After that, he goes for Nostradamus. With the additional alchemy, he has enough science to go for Code of Laws next turn. And then he takes the reserves with his last 2 civil actions. Mushan does draw some extra military cards from the Colossus, but he does not play an aggression, and you can imagine that I was really happy about it. And now he even gets hurt by an event, by the rebellion. And he has now some happy face problems and only 2 civil actions, so he has to destroy one of his mines and does not get out of corruption. So that yeah, that rebellion was definitely very bad for him. I definitely didn't want to push the deck. There's the foray in there, and now I can increase my strength a little bit, because I can now increase my population and build a knight and reveal the phalanx. I could have maybe revealed the phalanx at the turn before, so that I now draw one H2 military card more, but on the other hand, I wanted to draw a lot of cards to maybe get a defense card to be able to defend against Mushan. So yeah, I think it was maybe a fine decision to reveal it now. So I am now at 9 strength, or at 7 when I decide to use the civil action of Saladin. And then I decide to start upgrading my mines. I have now 6 resource production. And then the decision was between swordsman and richland. But I have a lot of resource production, and when I draw some nice tactics, I can maybe use the swordsman nicely. So I decided to pick up the swordsman. And yeah, that was quite a lucky draw. I only draw one card and it's a really nice tactic. So yeah, now I definitely want to get cannons, and yeah, with a strong economy and with this tactic, I think I am yeah, definitely have a nice position in this game. And Brom opens the red, sadly not a foray, and I lose 4 food, but at least I have some food production. And Brom makes an interesting decision, because I decided to maybe take the strength of Saladin, because Brom gets the immigration, another population that he could put into knights, maybe reveal even the heavy cavalry, and then I would be weakest. And when I take the strength of Saladin, I would at least be not the weakest, and Fight Rigger would be the weakest after Brom's turn. But Brom decides to finish the Taj Mahal instead, and maybe that's a little bit greedy, because building this knight, of course it depends on whether he has heavy cavalry or not, but if he has heavy cavalry, then he would be strongest when he builds the knight. Now he's the weakest, and I think that would be worth it to delay the Taj Mahal for one more turn to be strongest instead of weakest. But I of course was happy about it, and maybe when Fight Rigger plays an event in, I might be able to win the foray. And then Brom takes the rich land and the iron and the frugality. And he has the heavy cavalry, so yeah, maybe he should have built this knight instead. Fight Rigger reveals another territory, the wealthy territory, and Mushan is able to win it. And for one swordsman and one colonization card. Fight Rigger wants to get the rifleman, he wants to get in to increase his strength. And he upgrades one warrior, reveals the medieval army, and takes Bach. He has some alchemies, so he can maybe upgrade those later into operas, and then he can get a lot of culture without having to spend a lot of resources, because at the moment he does not have a lot of resource production. He has some nice science production, so he could maybe still go for coal, but yeah. Just having Bach could definitely be nice for him, but he does not get the drama, so he yeah, maybe has to pick operas for some extra civil action, depending on yeah, where this on the card run if the other players takes it. Take it. Then Mushan gets the constitutional monarchy. I would have liked this as well. I would not be able to go for it immediately. Mushan is, so he of course takes it. And he can now upgrade his first mine, and then he decides to take the Great Wall. That should be nice for him, getting some more strength in the happy phase will be nice as well for him at some point. Then it's my turn, and I definitely want to take the cannons, as I have the mobile artillery. And when we take a look at my civilization, I can increase my population next turn. But then I would have an unhappy worker, so I'm not really able to increase my population anytime soon, my strength anytime soon. Of course, I could go for swordsman, but that I don't want to do this with the mobile artillery in hand. But there's one way how I can increase my population next turn and build a knight, for example, and that's when I take the ocean liner service. And it's a really early ocean liner service, so I decided that it's worth it to pick this up for a lot of civil action. I don't have a lot of stuff to do anyway. Of course, I could take some yellow cards, but I think the ocean liner service this early should be really nice. I have some food production, but getting even more population out should put me in a nice position. Maybe I can go for a lot of military then in the late game. Yeah, and I have 13 resources at the next turn, so I can finish it, and then I get an extra yellow token, so then I can increase my population and build another knight, and then I could increase my strength if I have to. Yeah, and with this ocean liner service, I liked my position even more. So yeah, now I need a government farm, and then I really should have a nice position. And I draw the Napoleonic army, and that's a real alternative because I already have two warriors and I have the swordsman in hand, so I can decide for which tactic I want to go. Bram builds his additional knight now, and he goes for some iron up for one iron upgrade, takes the scientific method and the urban growth, so he can start upgrading this at the next turn. He has the masonry, so the upgrades are a little bit cheaper, and he can take the patriotism. Fight Rigger opens the foray, so sadly I wasn't able to win that one. And he decides to develop the Code of Laws. Takes the Statue of Liberty, now he has to get out of corruption, and he plays the reserves and builds one stage in it. And then he takes the other reserve so that he's able to finish it next turn. And I'm not sure about this decision. Of course, getting those three yellow tokens early should be quite nice, but he has not a lot of resource production, and that's definitely quite costly. So maybe instead of developing the Code of Laws, he could have maybe taken the selective breeding and started upgrading his food production. But yeah, the yellow tokens are not that bad, so let's see how that will work out for him. Mushan opens the cultural influence, and Bram gets the most out of it, but I also have a little bit of cultural production going. And Mushan goes for the selective breeding, can develop it, and has 17 resources after he won the wealthy territory with only 3 production, so that's quite an achievement. And then he goes for the cannons. He has the Great Wall, so he definitely wants to have the cannons. I didn't want to push the deck, because I'm still the weakest, and then I can finish the ocean liner service this turn. I can increase my population, and I still have enough resources to build a knight. And then I can take the revolutionary idea and the team spots. And I have some options here. I could take one of those yellow cards. Probably don't need the frugality because I will have a lot of population, but maybe the engineering genius. On the other hand, I have 3 wonders already, so taking another one would be quite costly. And I still need a government, and when I go for a government, a military technology, and then I already have used a lot of my science, so the revolutionary idea should be nice. But I kinda wanted to take the journalism, to be able to start converting my strong economy into some culture and even more science. But I decided that the team sports and the revolutionary idea are more important. And there is another copy of journalism, and it would take a while until I would go for the journalism, because before I go for them, I would probably first fix my happy faces, then go for military so that I'm not the weakest all the time, and then go for journalism. And that would take quite a while, and so I decided that I don't need to pick it up at this turn. Maybe I get the second copy, or I just go for operas, or even multimedias. So that would be some other options. And there's already the first copy of Organized Religion, so when I don't take the team spots, I could miss out on a happiness solution. And I didn't want to risk that, especially because I will get a lot of population, and it would be quite sad when those population is all unhappy. Yeah, so that was this turn, and I decided to take the strength of Saladin so that I'm not the weakest. Mushan is now the weakest. And I draw the scientific corporation. Bram opens the Good Harvest, so even more food. There's the Suez Canal, and there were some colonies, so let's see which player will get the Suez Canal. Bram can now go for scientific methods, can upgrade, and he takes the selective breeding as well, and the cannons. Fight Rigger opens the vast territory and Mushan wins it quite cheap, only for one swordsman, so that's nice for him. And Fight Rigger has to play the reserves this turn to be able to finish the Statue of Liberty. And then he gets the breakthrough, the rich land, and the frugality. And with the frugality he can increase his population 2 times at the next turn, so that's quite nice for him. Mushan plays an event even though he's weakest, so it seems that he does not expect any strength events, and he opens the scientific breakthrough. Takes the architecture, he can use that on the Great Wall immediately. And it will be nice when he goes for some urban buildings or wonders at a later point. He has a lot of food, so maybe the Red Cross will be an option later for him. And he can finish the Great Wall. Now he has one civil action left and use that to increase his population and rebuild the swordsman, so he is now the strongest again. And I didn't want to push, I am the weakest again. Of course, Mushan just played an event in as weakest, and a turn after that he is strongest. So maybe I can just play something in, but I decided to offer the scientific cooperation, and I did not really expect Fight Rigger to accept this pact. We both have a lot of science saved up, and he has even more production, and he has to break the rules. So it definitely makes sense for him. But I already have a lot of technologies in hand, so because of that I thought that he maybe would not accept. But he has a lot of science, and he has a lot of civil actions, so yeah, this pack should be nice for him as well. And there is the Republic at the card draw, and there's only one constitutional monarchy left. All the other players have a government already, but yeah, I had a decision to make whether I want to wait for the constitutional monarchy or whether I want to go for Republic. I didn't like the Republic that much here because I have a strong economy, and Bram, for example, goes for has some culture already, and when I go for Republic, I really make it really makes it a lot harder to go for some military, and I'm really nicely set up for military. I have 2 nice tactics, I can decide for which one I want to go. I have my happiness solution, I have a lot of population, and my resource production is nice as well. So I probably can set up quite a big military. So I kind of wanted to let this option open. But maybe I get a strategy, it is still in the deck, so then that would still be an option. And after I decided that I want to go for Republic because it's just a really big boost for my economy, I can use the Scientific Cooperation Pact. So after that pact got accepted, I definitely wanted to go for the Republic. But when I go for the Republic, then I decided to go for Catherine so that I have the third military action immediately, because with this pact accepted, the Open Borders Agreement was cancelled. So I am now at only 2 military actions, I wanted to get my third one back. So I decided to go for Republic and then for Catherine. And then I wanted to increase my military a little bit so that I at least maybe can threaten to take the yellow tokens away. So I increased my population first normally, then with the ocean liner service, and built one cannon. Now I had to decide for which tactic I want to go, or of course I could also decide to not reveal any of those tactics. But when I have more strength, then as I said, I threatened to take the yellow token away. That would put a little bit of pressure on the other player, so I decided to reveal the tactic, but I decided to go for the Napoleonic army. With the Scientific Cooperation Pact, it is really cheap to go for the swordsman as well, and I have those warriors already. And the other argument is that Bram is really nicely set up for the mobile artillery, so I really didn't want to give this tactic to him. And of course, the Napoleonic army might be nice for the other players, and Bram could use that as well when he gets the rifleman, when Fight Rigger. There is no copy of cannon left, so that was, I think that was another reason. So Fight Rigger would be quite nice set up for the Napoleonic army when he gets the cannons, but all the cannons are already out, so That was the reason why I went for the Napoleonic army. It's one strength less for this turn. Yeah, but I really didn't want to give this tactic to Bram. And I draw the Ravages of Time, but can maybe play it in, but Bram has Forbidden City and Stonehenge, so losing the Stonehenge might be not that bad for him. Fight Rigas, a lot of civil actions and the pyramids. Mushan is the Colossus, so we all have wonders that wouldn't be maybe not that bad to lose, so it's not really the best event. And Bram offers the international trade agreement, he wants some extra resource production, and Fire Trigger gets some extra food production. And he decides to go for the Suez Canal, he has two colonies already, so that's definitely nice for him that he gets the Suez Canal. And he builds an extra knight, and that definitely will make the transition harder for another tactic. I know that he cannot have the mobile artillery, maybe he has hussars, so that could definitely be just... Or did he just take it? Yeah. He just took the cavalryman. Yeah, but so maybe this was already a nice... the pressure was maybe already nice in the decision to reveal the tactic, because without that he maybe wouldn't have built this knight, and that yeah, definitely will make it harder for him to transition to another tactic. Fightrigger can use the frugality now to increase his population. He builds another rifleman, reveals the classic army. So he is now the strongest, and he decides to go for justice system, even though he had code of laws already. So he has a lot of science. He has the scientific cooperation pact. So he pays basically two civil actions and five science to get 3 blue cubes. It's definitely an interesting decision. But he has a lot of science, so maybe it's worth it, but I'm not really sure about it. Then he has some civil actions left, and he takes the architecture, the opera, and journalism. And yeah, he has not really a lot of resources, so the journalism is an interesting pickup, but maybe when he gets his resources up, that could be nice. He still has the rich lands, so he could maybe go for coal. Yeah, and instead of going for the justice system, he could have grabbed a breakthrough. Yeah, so that's definitely an interesting decision. Especially because he's the Statue of Liberty, so he, it would be really nice for him to get an H3 government. And then getting the breakthrough instead investing science into this could definitely be nice for him. But then again, he has of course the pact with me, and yeah, maybe he just didn't want to not use this pact at all. And Mushan opens the crusade. Sadly, at the moment, I am the weakest, so that was certainly not the best timing. And yeah, Fightrigger is the strongest and wins the crusades. Mushan decides to go for navigation, gets another resource out of Leonardo. Then he takes James Cook, elects him, takes the breakthrough. And yeah, he has now 4 colonization bonus, so he, when there are some colonies, he could get them quite cheaply with Cook and this bonus. I'm the weakest again, so again, I didn't want to push the deck. And there's the strategy, I was definitely happy about that. And so I can develop it immediately to get even stronger. And then I can either go for Swordsman, I definitely want to develop the Swordsman. But I can either just upgrade those two Swordsmen, or I can build another cannon to go for another outdated army. Definitely wanted to build the team spots to fix my happy. And to be prepared if there's a bad event about that would punish me having unhappy workers, because when the age will end, then I really would have a lot of unhappy workers, so that was for sure that I wanted to build a team spots. And it also gives some additional strength. I decided to build another cannon, and now I'm at 25, and At the next turn, I should have the option to use the Catherine to get another yellow token. And I draw some colonies and one colonization card. Brum starts building on the Suez Canal, he develops the cannons. Then he takes Maria Theresa, elects her, so he gets some civil actions back from Eleanor. And then he finishes the Suez Canal, and we can take a look at what colony he got. And it is the inhabited territory, and that is really nice with Maria Theresa. So he immediately gains two science and two culture out of her. So that was definitely nice. He has not a lot of food, so he might not get a lot of population out at the next turns. But he has not a lot of population, so at the next turns he can use probably his her 3 resource ability. And yeah, so she should be really nice for him. And now the age ends and Phaedra loses Nostradamus. Maybe he should have elected Bach at the last turn. But there also was a chance that age would not end, and then he could maybe have a little bit more information about what events are in the deck, and he could maybe get the bonus of Nostradamus one more time. Now he goes for Bach, he goes for architecture, opera, he has a lot of science, can use the science pact nicely, and he decides to upgrade his first lab into opera for only one resource. Or is it for one? Yeah, for one resource. And he takes the selective breeding. So he can start upgrading his food production with the rich land. Mushan opens the autonomous territory, and I did a really crazy bid for that. I think I bid a whole army. I didn't really want to get. Wanted that one of the other players gets the colony for really cheap, and I kinda could rebuild my army, but I'm not sure if I really wanted to win it or if I just wanted to make the other players pay more. And Mushan was able to win it, and it is still quite cheap for him. He just gets it for one swordsman and a colossus still doing some work and giving him an H3 defense card, and he's decided to take the resources out of this colony. He still is at 3 resource production after he had to destroy the mine at the beginning of H2, and he decides to go for 2 cannons. Is now at 23 strength, can use the Great Wall nicely, takes the fission upgrade, so he can maybe finally upgrade his last mine, or he can just use it to upgrade his temple to organized religion. And he has the tactic that he wants, that you want to have with the Great Wall, the defensive army, and he has now 27 strength. And I have now the decision whether I want to play an event in or whether I want to use Catherine, and I decided to use Catherine. Like this, I can maybe delay. I'm going for more happiness, and at this turn I also decided to pick the opera up, then the happiness of the opera would maybe last a little bit longer when I decide to go for this. And at this turn I used my military actions, my 2-3 military actions, to upgrade 2 warriors to swordsmen, so I'm the strongest again. And yeah, I can take the reserves, the revolutionary idea. No, I already have this, but reserves and efficient upgrade. Yeah. And I decided to pick up this revolutionary idea as well. And the opera, as I said, because I'm quite nice set up for military, especially when I would get air forces. Of course, I still need a war. But yeah, I of course don't know if I will draw a war, and I definitely want to have an option for just some going for some culture as well. And because of that I decided to go for opera. There's also Marlene and Charlie Chaplin and Fleming when I go for multimedia as well, so some nice leaders, and the opera should be quite nice here. And then I play the revolutionary idea and I draw my first war, And when there's a nice air force timing, I could go for this war immediately the next turn. That would be quite strong. On the other hand, I don't have enough resources for two air forces, only for one. So, but still, it could that could still be enough for a nice war. Brom builds one lab with the urban growth. Placed a patriotism, has now 6 additional resources for military, builds 1 cannon, builds 1 rifleman, and copies the Napoleonic army, is now 23 strength, and he decides to go for Bill Gates. Maria was a really nice transitioning leader, giving him 2 culture, 2 science, and 3 resources, and now he gets some extra resource production with Bill Gates, and he really has a lot of resource production now. 4 mines, the Suez Canal, and Bill Gates. So now he has to find a way to invest those resources, and then he could really have a nice position, because he has the culture lead at the moment. And yeah, when he finds a nice way to spend those resources, then he probably has the best position now. Fightrigger takes the military build-up. He has not a lot of resource production. With Bach, he might get a lot of culture production, and he has to defend his culture somehow, so military build-up is a really nice card for him. He uses his wave of nationalism to go for tanks, and he upgrades 2 knights to tanks. Still has corruption, so he could increase his population, or he can go for selective breeding, and with the rich land, he is able to get out of corruption. And Mushan opens the civil unrest, but no one has any unhappy workers. He upgrades his second mine finally, builds another swordsman, so he's the strongest again, takes the modern infantry, increases his population, takes the reserves, develops the organized religion, and increases his population another time. There's Mandela, so you could maybe go for him next turn. And he has an unhappy worker, but has some way to get some happiness. But Cook is also giving him 4 cultural production at the moment, so that's not bad for me as well. I decided to play the crime wave in. I definitely wanted to push the deck. There are no air forces. I could maybe go for a war, but I don't know. Then I can maybe make this war even bigger, and then I draw some more cards, and maybe can go for 2 wars or something like that. But there are no air forces, and without air forces, it could be a little bit tricky to pull off a war, especially because Brum could just destroy some mines, go for more armies. Mushan has his great wall and defensive army, and Fightrigger is probably the most vulnerable, but he has the military build-up, so he has some potential as well. So I decided to go not all in war, and I built 1 opera at this point. And another thing that I want to do is to not increase my population normally, only when I need to get out of corruption, so that I have the option to go for the Red Cross with maybe 3 stages or something like that, and I can increase my population with the ocean liner service and save up a little bit of food for the International Red Cross. Yeah, with the opera I'm not 8 culture production, and then I took the revolutionary idea, the reserves, and I have 1 civil action left, and I decided to use the Finchton upgrade to upgrade another one of my mines to go up to 7 resource production. And yeah, so now I definitely was hoping to get air forces, and because that would make it a lot easier to go a war for me. I could of course pick one of those technologies and maybe prepare to go for an H3 tactic, but yeah, Air Forces would at this point be the best technology for me, and I can still use the Ocean Liner service to increase my population. And there's the Modern Army, so, but going for this would cost a lot of resources. Brum builds cannon and riflemans, develops the military theories. So sadly, I would now lose my crime wave, but I could maybe play the Iconoclasm, but I have still Catherine, so that was not the best event to play. The National Agreement could definitely boost the turn of another player a lot, and those impacts are not great as well. Impact of Colony is definitely quite bad, as it is quite nice for Brum and Mushan, and I will probably have not more food production than consumption when the impact of agriculture is evaluated. So, I didn't want to push one of those impacts, so I decided to still go for the crime wave, and hopefully I will not be one of the two weakest when this one is revealed, but at the moment I would be. And Bram gets the movies, and but he delays his food upgrades. That could be a little bit problematic. He builds another scientific method, and but he takes the movies, so he can invest some resources into that technology. And he takes the mechanized agriculture, so at the next turn he should probably start upgrading his food production. Instead of the food, he went for the military theory to draw three additional cards, so that definitely was not a bad decision, but no. Next turn he can then maybe go for food. And Faitrigger offers the military alliance to Mushan. I was not too happy about it because at this point of the game I already knew that probably I have to beat Mushan to still have a chance at the first place. And one way would definitely to go for a war, and like this, he has three additional strength. And Faitrigger uses Bach one last time to upgrade another alchemy into opera, and then he goes for Marlene. So that means that he probably wants to use a military ability immediately. He can use the military build up. Has enough food to increase his population 2 times, but now the next population would take a while. And he can build one rifleman and one tank, and is now at 45 strength. But he has now only 3 resources, decides to develop the journalisms. Maybe again because of the scientific cooperation, but he should maybe save the science up to be able to go for military theory. There's one copy left, or to have some other options, because with his resource production, it is not that likely that he will build one journalist. Maybe he gets an urban growth or reserves, but he probably does not want to reuse the reserves on that, and rather to keep it in hand as a little bit of to have more military potential. So yeah, probably the other cards here weren't that great for him as well, so he just decided to go for this journalism, but hey, maybe he will miss the science at a later point. Mushan opens the terrorism, and that's quite bad. I just built my opera, and yeah, and I only have a little bit more culture than Mushan. That's definitely a bad event, and Faitrigger loses an opera as well. Brum loses a scientific method, and I lose my opera, so that was a really strong event for Mushan. Basically, yeah, a raid against all our players, not really, because he doesn't get the resources, but yeah, often there's one player who maybe just loses a lab or something, but in that case, every player lost a really expensive building at the beginning of age 3, or maybe it's already not quite the beginning anymore, but definitely a strong event for him. And he decides to go for Mandela, gets an extra civil action, will produce a little bit less culture unless he builds another organized religion immediately, but he gets the civil action and has potential to increase his culture that he gains from Mandela even more at a later point. So yeah, Mandela should be nice for him, and he goes up to 55 strength. That's quite a lot, and yeah, that I have to see how I respond to that. I still have no event that I really want to play in. Of course, I could now play the Iconoclasm, and it would take a while until it is revealed, but I'm the weakest, and yeah. First, I thought that I maybe want to rebuild the opera, but I really have to Don't want to risk losing aggression against Mushan. And so I decided to invest more into military. And hopefully I will get maybe the air forces at some point so that I can then go for war. And at this turn I decided to just build another Napoleonic army. Having a lot of population definitely is nice at this point. And I have get a patriotism, so I have 16 resources at the next turn, which means I could go for Air Force, two Air Forces. And because of unhappiness problems and because I don't have enough resources to build a team spot in addition to the two Air Forces, I would have to delete one mine to get a population. But I would have two resources left. So at a turn, and I would produce six, so at a turn after the potential war turn, I would ha still have enough resources to invest into another air force when I have the chance to go for a second war, or to go for one opera, because the leader that I was looking for at this point was definitely Chaplin. I mean, Einstein could work as well, but I invested now a lot of my science already, and I don't have a science building, so he would not give me an additional science production at the moment. And I could definitely use the happy faces of Chaplin, and I have could build an opera, so he was the leader I was looking for at this point. I have two revolutionary ideas, so I have some science, and I decided to go for satellites. That is some additional strength. Can use the Scientific Cooperation Pact, and I still have enough science to go for air forces. And with my last two selections, I decided to just use those two revolutionary ideas. And I draw even another war, but there is probably not enough time left to go for three wars. Bram goes for food production now. Can use the fission upgrade to upgrade one of the farms. Then he builds another cannon. Destroys a mine and builds another rifleman. And he gets the first copy of Air Force, and he is prepared for war as well. He has three Napoleonic armies as well, and has as well enough resources to go for two Air Forces. So, yeah, and he has two strength more at the moment, so he's even a little bit better set up for war than me. Fightrigger opens the Cold War. And yeah, Mushan and Bram sadly gain some extra strength. By the way, I think I forgot to mention. I think I had the ability to use the freedom of movement. Yeah, that was at turn 14, and I sadly at this point didn't find a way to use this freedom of movement nicely. Could have maybe put a mine into military, but at this point it was not for sure whether I want to have more of those units or whether I just go for a culture play, and it, so I didn't really want to delete or to get rid of the mine. Yeah, so I forgot to mention this. But let's get back to Fightrigger's turn. He gets revolutionary idea and military theory, so he gets those cards together. So developing the journalism was not too bad. He still can go for the military theory. And Mushan opens the politics of strength, gets some additional card. That's definitely nice for him, and Fightrigger will miss out on his next card draw. And there is the Red Cross. Mushan has a lot of food, can play the reserves for food, can even go for civil service. And then he can finish the International Red Cross in one go. There are seven colonies, so that's a lot of culture for him. But he, with going for the civil service, he has not enough science to go for a potential air force. And he has not enough science resources to go for another army, so maybe he is a little bit vulnerable. So when a air force, one of the two last copies of air forces show up now, then yeah, maybe I can punish this player, because now he definitely has the culture lead, has a really nice position with his many civil actions. Yeah, so let's see if there is an air force. And as you can see, there is an air force, and I decided to go for war against Mushan. This decision was definitely influenced by the tournament standings. First of all, I need to win this game, so even without tournament standings, it could still be the best to go for Mushan when I really want to win this game. But maybe with some other standings I would go against Fightrigger, because he has not a lot of resources, can go for military theory, cannot go for another army, cannot really go for an air force unless there's an event revealed. So the war would definitely be bigger against him. But I have to stop Mushan somehow. I want to win this, and I want to still keep my chances of winning the league. It's a little bit risky because he has not enough resources to build another army, but when there is economic progress, then it gets already quite risky because he would get 4 additional resources. With 11 resources he can build another army, and he has professional spots and an urban growth in hand, which means that he could go for another army and 1 professional spots, then I would already lose the war. And I think I kind of forgot to think about that, that he can build a professional spots that cheaply. So I just thought about the additional army. That was definitely a mistake. So there is definitely some risk, but maybe that's still the right decision when we take the tournament standings in perspective. I have to take some risks, I think, to keep my chances of winning the league. And there's the risk, of course, when I go against Fightrigger, that he might resign. He's already not... I'm at the moment have the least culture, but he has not a lot of culture as well. And when I go for him against with the war, he could resign. There are still a lot of reasons not to resign, because there could maybe be some more wars against some other players, so I'm definitely not sure that he would resign, but... I decided to go against Mushan. So let's take a look at my turn. I have to play Reserves and the Patriotism to have enough resources to go for 2 air forces. I used the Ocean Liner service, and then I increased my population normally. I did this on purpose in this order, so that I have less food, because I don't really need any more food, and having 5 food just might cause some corruption problems. And I can go for 2 air forces, can go up to 74 strength, and that's all I can do. And so there was not a lot of to consider. The only thing to consider was against whom I want to go with the war, and if I want to go for the war, but that was quite for certain. And as I already said at the last turn, I have no 8 resources, so I can still go for 1 opera the next turn, hopefully together with Chaplin. There's also the engineering left. I have enough science to maybe go for that. And because it is not likely that I have another chance for a second war, because Fightrigger and Mushan have really a lot of civil actions. So the age will probably end, and Brum joins in the war against Mushan. So that definitely gives some hope that maybe I can overtake Mushan in the tournament standings. And Brum can go for 2 air forces as well, decides to destroy his farm, and is at 76 strength. He gets the fission upgrade and growth. And he didn't play an event because he of course went for the war, so that's quite nice. And I really hope that there was no bad event that would help Mushan. And Fightrigger plays an event and the arms industry is opened. But that does not give enough resources to Mushan to build another army. He could now build another outdated army. That wasn't possible before as well. He could now do that, so it definitely helps him, but it is not enough for him to go for a full army. And Fightrigger decides to go for the fast food chains, grabs the reserves and engineering genius. And then he builds 2 stages to get out of corruption, and I think that's also really smart, because he has not a lot of strength, so he definitely has to expect some aggressions. And like this, he can finish this for sure, even when he gets plundered, because he has now built those 2 stages already, and he has engineering genius and reserves in hand. There is no kidnap in H3, so yeah, he can finish this wonder for sure, and that's definitely nice for him. And now let's see if Mushan gets another nice event. And it is the event that I feared the most. Yeah, and sadly it is there. Of course, I and Brum cannot bid for this. Mushan has a big colonization bonus, and Fire Trigger was not willing to bid a lot for this as well. So sadly, that will definitely help Mushan a lot. He gets it for one swordsman. First, he takes some cards, probably to just anti-age. Can develop professional spots, can increase his population once, can build one professional spots for one resource, and then he can destroy a lot of stuff and build some units. And he really destroys a lot, has no resource production anymore, and builds a cannon, a swordsman, another swordsman, another swordsman, and another swordsman. So as you can see, he wins now the war against both of us, so that definitely must have felt really nice for him. And yeah, sadly, it was a little bit risky to go for the war against him, and sadly, I was punished for this decision. Still think it was maybe the right one, maybe not, because one economic progress would have been enough as well. I just considered a wealthy territory and kinda overlooked that the professional spots only cost one resource for him, and that economic progress would have been enough as well for him, so maybe it was a little bit too risky to go for the war against him. Yeah, but Rom decided to go for the war against him as well, and then he got two nice events. Last event here is the crime wave, so that definitely would have been a lot better instead of the wealthy territory. But yeah, that's definitely a nice turn of events for him. And with that, my hopes of winning the league are probably gone, but let's see what I can do in my last turn. First of all, I lose 9 culture to Mushan. But I can play an aggression against Fight Rigger to gain some extra culture. It was not worth it to go for the raid, and the impact of agriculture is not really great. And I can go for Charlie Chaplin. I can go for the engineering, and then thanks to the arm industry, at least it did give something to me as well. I can build the upper air and still have some resources left. And of course, thanks to the engineering. And I decided to build a team spot. Another option would maybe be a religion. But a team spot is better for impact of architecture, is better for impact of competition. The religion could matter for impact of culture, maybe. But the chance is higher that the team spots will matter for potential impact of strength. Because Brum will probably not increase his strength, he has some happy face problems already, and only when he maybe has the impact of strength for himself, then he would maybe go for more strength. But when not, I don't think he would do this. So, and then with the team spots we have the same strength, and then I would win the tiebreaker when it is revealed after Brum's turn. And when Brum doesn't play an event in, and that's also not unlikely because he can play an aggression against Fire Trigger that he wins for sure as well when he has one, then there's also the crime wave, and after his turn when he doesn't increase his strength, I would win or not lose the crime wave. When Brum plays an event in, then I would lose it. So a lot of reasons to go for the team spot instead of the religion. And I at least get some culture production, thanks to the opera and Chaplin. And I am prepared for some impacts. And Mushan played a lot of impacts in. There are 3 impacts, one was played in by Fight Trigger. And he had to destroy now a lot, so there could be some impacts in that are better for me than for him. But he is, of course, now a big lead, so... there are... Maybe with the perfect combination of impacts, there is a chance left that I overtake him, but it's really unlikely. But let's see if I can maybe overtake Brum or Fight Trigger. First of all, Mushan steals some culture from Brum as well, and Brum goes for an aggression against Fightrigger as well, another armed intervention. Brum has to fix his happy face problem, so he goes for one opera, and he has enough resources to even go for another opera. Then he can take the multimedia, and that was his last turn. And Fightrigger can finish the fast food chains, but can build something before that to get a little bit of additional culture from the fast food chains. And he decides to build a theology. Would be nice for Impact of Harmony, Impact of Agriculture, Impact of Happiness. He is of course not enough to build another opera. And he can finish the fast food chains for I think 19 points, yes. And then he can still develop one technology, the military theories, nice for some impacts. And then he picks up the coal, the oil. And Mushan basically can do nothing because he has only one resource. The crime wave is revealed now, so that worked quite nicely. But of course I would have preferred it when this and the wealthy territory would have been the other way around, and I would have not lost the crime wave as well. And Mushan can take the air forces, the endowment for the arts, the empire state building and the computers, but he cannot really do anything that would help him in any way. Yeah, so let's take a look at the culture before the final impact evaluation. And Mushan definitely has a big lead, but his impacts can, maybe they are bad, but he played a lot of those impacts in, he just played an impact in as well. So, but some of those impacts probably were played before, or the most impacts were played before he had to destroy that much. So there could be some impacts in there that are bad for him. And I think the other impact is from Fightrigger. There are only five impacts. Yeah, so let's see. I'm the last one at the moment, but I'm not that bad prepared for the impact, so maybe I can overtake Fightrigger, maybe even Brum, but no. Let's see. And the first impact is the impact of strength. This team sport was worth a lot, and that should secure the win for Mushan. And yeah, and with that it is nice for me, because I at least catch up to the other players. Then there is the impact of progress, that's a good one for Mushan as well. But it is very good for me as well, so I almost already catched up Fightrigger, and I am not that far away from Brum as well. Then there's the impact of science, that one is good for Brum, but I'm at least the second in this impact, so I overtake Fightrigger. And then there's the impact of population. I'm not sure which player played this impact in, because that's really strong for me. And it's not strong for Mushan and for Fightrigger, so that was maybe Mushan played this impact in to open the wealthy territory, because he played a lot of those H2 events, and probably this was one of his events, and then he maybe had to open this, and maybe didn't want to play the impact of strength in and went for the impact of population. That would be one explanation for this, but I was of course really happy about it, because that is a really strong impact for me. And now there's one impact left, and I could still overtake Brum, so let's see what impact it is. It is the impact of happiness, and it is only 8 for Brum, but 16 for me, so I overtake Brum. But of course there's the Bill Gates bonus, so Brum overtakes me again, sadly. And I end up at a third place. Yeah, definitely an interesting game. Sadly, I was not able to win it. But I can tell you now that Mushan then won his last match, because I waited to record the video until all game is finished, so that I can talk now a little bit about the final standings. So yeah, Mushan would have won the league even when he would lost those wars, and maybe ended up even at the last place, because yeah, he was able to win the other game as well. Sadly, I was not able to end up at the second place, but at least I was not last. And yeah, maybe it was too greedy to go for the war against Mushan, but on the other hand, it was my big chance to still win the league. Maybe I should have gone against Fightrigger anyway. Yeah, but let's take a look at the final standings. Mushan played a really strong season. He won all of his four player games and ended up at the first place with 33 points. 13 points behind it, I and Freddy Krueger Killer both with 20 points, but I have won two games against him, he only won against me, so I'm at the second place and Freddy Krueger Killer is at the third place. The fourth place is Wyvie with 19 points, only 1 point less, so it's really close between me, Freddy Krueger Killer and Wyvie. Then Brum is at the fifth place with 13 points. But he timed out in three matches, so I think the rule is that when you time out three times, then you are placed at the last place. Maybe he has a really good excuse, and then Payada might have mercy. I'm not sure how the rules are then, there are no excuses, and he is definitely placed at the last place, so I don't know about that, but I was definitely happy that he still played the four remaining matches after he timed out three times. So I don't had to play against the bot once. Then at the two last place, at the second last place is Fightrigger. He lost this match and sadly wasn't able to stay in the league, and he has 8 points, but maybe when Brum is placed last, I don't know, maybe then it is still enough for him to stay in the league. I don't know exactly how that will be executed. And at the last place is Frotus, who won the International Championship 3 times. The season didn't really went great for him, and he is now relegated again, so that, is not the best turns of events for him, but maybe he will fight his way back up. He definitely is a really strong player and has shown that at the last year when he won the International Championship 3 times. So I ended up at the second place, and not overtaking Brum here might have consequences, because in the other Masters League, the second place there is PV4 with 22 points. I have now 20 points. When I would have ended up at the second place, I would have had 22 points as well. And it could be that one of the players at the Grandmasters League don't sign up for the next season. It's summer, so maybe some people want to do some more things outside. And then, like it is now, PV4 would then be rank up to the Grandmaster Division. When I would have ended up at second place here, then I don't know how the rule would then be. Maybe I think then there would be maybe one additional match to show which player will end up in the Grandmaster Division. But that, of course, is only a thing when one of the players in the Grandmaster Division would not sign up for the next season. Yeah, so I hope you enjoyed this games of the season. I think there's definitely were a lot of interesting games, and again in these games with a really nice turn of events for Mushan, sadly not for me, but I think that was a really nice turn for him to win two wars that were declared against him in his defense. Yeah, and I also just reached 100 subscribers, so thank you a lot for that. I didn't really plan to do a YouTube channel. When I recorded the turns for my first match before the replay feature, I just wanted to try it out and see how it goes. And then the replay feature was revealed, or was released, and that made things a lot easier. And yeah, I definitely enjoy sharing my games with you, and I'm happy that there are some of you who enjoy those games and taking a look at them. Yeah. So then, the next games will probably be the ones of the Intermezzo Championship, where I play the Grandmaster Division again. I think that the Intermezzo Championship starts this weekend, but I'm not totally sure, so I have to check this again. Yeah, and then see you in the next video.